in education, the rise in poverty, and what's happening at the same time is that laws are being passed and policies are being passed, not only in Canada but in many Western countries, against immigrants, against refugees, restricting the number of immigrants, restricting the number of refugees, giving more powers to consular offices to decide who should come to Canada. And within Canada itself, we have now a two-tier citizenship. There's two types of citizens. There's citizens who are treated fully under the Charter of Rights and Freedom, and there are those who are marginalized, like what happened to Abu Sufyan Abdul Razak, Saad Haji Mahmoud, Maher Arar, and others. And we also have within Canada now a government that is attempting to muzzle the freedom of expression of Canadians on many issues, international issues and domestic issues.
She is a climate and environmental justice organizer based here in Toronto, working with the Rainforest Action Network and People for Climate Justice, mainly focusing on issues regarding the tar sands and Canada's role internationally. She has worked with the Sierra Club Atlantic and the Sustainability Office at Queen's University, working on public environmental education projects. She recently returned from the UN Conference on Climate Change as one of the action coordinators for the Canadian Youth Delegation and is currently working among the youth climate movement in Canada to build skills and networks nationally. Please welcome Miriam.
The G8 and G20 are undermining communities' ability to determine the fate of the land they live on, the water they drink, and the air they breathe. And when I talk about environmental justice and climate justice, it's not about justice for the climate or the environment, it's about justice for the people who are suffering from environmental degradation and climate change. Take the Alberta tar sands. The tar sands is one of the largest environmental injustices on this planet, and it is not on the G8 or the G20 agenda. The tar sands are taking over pristine boreal forests, or it's taking over unceded Aboriginal territory, putting contaminants in the water, causing people to suffer from higher rates of autoimmune diseases, cardiovascular diseases, cancers, asthmas, and this is all mainly happening in Aboriginal territories. This is these environmental injustices are not just in Alberta, they're happening all across Canada. In Northern Ontario, in indigenous communities like Grassy Narrows, we have mercury poisoning, poisoning water, and poisoning food supplies like fish. And in low-income communities like in Sarnia and Windsor, we have diesel fleets causing increased asthma rates. This is happening in low-income communities and communities of color. This is unacceptable. Canada is not solving the problem here at home, and they're not solving it or helping solve it abroad. The United Nations has approached Canada and told Canada that they need to put climate change on the forefront of the G20 agenda, and Canada has refused. This is absolutely unacceptable. And as a G8 country, Canada does not need to exploit people or the planet for its own economic benefit or for the benefit of an already wealthy few. The federal government is trying to solve these issues by promoting market-based solutions, but it's these markets that cause the problems in the first place. The G20 is a self-selected group of 20, and they are undermining the United Nations processes, and they're bringing these injustices here at home. Many Aboriginal communities are suffering from water boiling advisories. This is unacceptable. These problems are coming here at home. And this June, the environmental justice and climate justice movements are going to come and join other movements to transcend with these other movements and to join them and to show that our struggles are all the same.
Thank you, Miriam.
Just want to show response to the concern about violence. If people in Toronto residents are concerned about violence, they should talk to the police who murdered two people in the past month.
That's right.
And they should talk with each other and think about the kind of violence that's happening
that's
around
right.
them.
That's right.
How many groups are represented here today, and will there be people coming from all across the country in your march or protest?
Yeah, we're getting emails from across the country and around the world. Our priority is local movements, though, and making the local concerns, bringing them forth, and getting them heard in a global stage. This is an incredible opportunity for people who work on different issues who don't come together to work together. Say, oh yeah, you're working on the tar sands, you're working on poverty, let's make it the connections, you're working on health.
You had said that we didn't ask for it to come here.
Mm-hmm.
So what percentage of Torontonians do you think we speak for?
Well, I don't know how many people actually asked for it to come here. I don't think they were based in Toronto.
But what do you think you speak for? 50% of all people, or 5%, or just that's
Harper? I mean, Harper brought the G20 summit to Toronto to celebrate the success story, the economic success story of Canada. And what we want to say is this is not a success story when social assistance rates are being cut, when the planet is being harmed, when child care spots aren't being available, when immigrants are being picked up on the streets.
That's me.
But that doesn't matter. You're not helping me. Like, do you think you speak for the majority?
But what I will say is that I think that it is a piece of incredible audacity to bring together a collection of people who are imposing such poverty and misery and using military means to do that throughout the world, bring them together, put them in an armed camp, and then on the and then say, do you think somebody might break a window, or do you think somebody might scuffle with the cops? Isn't that appalling? Don't speak to the mosquitoes, speak to the vampire bats.
Right.
That's first of all true. But I'll also say this. If you are going to impose this of poverty and misery on people throughout this planet, don't think that you're going to be able to ask them to confine themselves to sedate, nice, polite methods of struggle. People, by God, are going to resist, and they have a damn right to.
A couple of things. I think it is absolutely not true that to say that violence has been imposed globally on people by the institutions that are meeting in this city, to decry that, to speak out against that, to speak angrily about that, means that you then support other kinds of violence. I don't square that circle or whatever at all. That I don't think that makes sense. One, somebody asked about messages, and I think it's really important to say that a lot of control over what the message out of this summit is in your hands, the media's hands. And if you remain
right.
obsessed with protesters' violence, then indeed that will be the message that comes out of this summit.
That's right.
If you get obsessed with the messages that people have talked about today, and if we are able to let the world know that Stephen Harper does not speak for women's rights, for maternal and children's rights, that he has no expertise and in fact is talking out of both sides of his mouth.
Yeah.
On the one hand saying that he supports maternal and child health, and on the other hand destroying and taking actions that will undermine women's and maternal and child health, then that's the message that has to get out there. That's certainly our interest. The notion that Stephen Harper would position himself and his government as any kind of advocate or expert on gender equality is ridiculous, and we need to make that message loud and clear. Otherwise, you folks have a lot of control over what you decide to focus on. When a woman gets killed in her home, or when a police officer kills someone on the street, why don't we get obsessed about that? When over 500 indigenous women in this country have gone missing and have been murdered, where is the outcry? Where is the concern about violence? Where is the outrage and the weeks and weeks of preoccupation with that violence? That violence hurts much more than a bomb in a bank. And that violence has effects for generations to come. A bomb in a bank will be fixed. The damage will be fixed in about a month. The damage to women's lives that happens in this city, in this province, in this country, and around the world every day will be with us for generations. And you guys need to get on top of that. You need to understand that. That is so much more.